For extraordinary experiences at music concerts, at sporting events, or even at the movies. Imagine a place where you can be the star and not just a spectator. I think I can help.
In the rest of the world, people are creating immersive theater experiences in castles, palaces, ancient cultural sites. But here in America, we have a national treasure that no one's used for this yet. Battleships. At Legends of the Stars, you enter a universe torn apart by warring factions, where diplomats are heading to neutral space to make decisions that will determine the fate of the universe. In preparation for Legends of the Stars, our production team is going to immense lengths to provide a one-of-a-kind experience. We're going to be designing characters and systems for every single participant unique to the Legends of the Stars world. We will be sending in trained actors to create interesting plots and dilemmas for your characters to make decisions on, bringing to life the world of Legends of the Stars.
At the event, you will experience amazing things on these ships. The engine room, the artillery cannons, the CIC room, the immense endless maze of the battleship. As you will discover, there's a lot to explore. As a player, you have the power to make your own path. You can be representing your star system, making alliances with other systems, perhaps you're making a secret rival pact, or perhaps you're discovering the truth of your own power.
Legends of the Stars is being organized by LARP Adventure Program, a community of LARP professionals who have been running LARP experiences in New England for the past 10 years.
Why do I LARP? And I LARP because it's an exciting and challenging adventure. You get to meet really cool and interesting people, and you find out things about yourselves and others in a way that you just couldn't before. And you immerse yourself in an experience that's like no other in the world.
We are the Maiv, the noble knights of the Dawin, first of the orders and those who defend the universe from the savages who seek to do it harm. We believe in the unending value of beauty and growth, life and pleasure. We will be the architects of the stars as we give and protect the gift of life wherever it may flourish.
We are the Sejay, the hidden servants of the Dawin, last of the orders and those who save the universe from its own mortal trappings. We believe in the necessity of death in the natural cycle to make room for new life. We will be the shepherds of the stars as we guide all to that which waits for every one of us at the end. A new beginning.
I'm Jeremy Springfield. I'm from Framingham, Massachusetts.
I'm Evan Driscoll, and I live in Somerville, Massachusetts.
I'm Jessica Holm from Shirley, Massachusetts.
I'm Dory Shindell, and I'm from all over the place. I'm a Navy brat.
I'm Kevin Shindell. I currently live in Medford.
My name is Alexan Mardigian, and I live in Somerville.
My name's Hugh Long. I'm originally from Brewster, New York. Currently, I'm living in Somerville, Massachusetts.
Day-to-day as a quality assurance engineer for a company that runs financial services products.
I run a LARP company called LARP Adventure Program.
For work, I'm an electronics technician, so I build systems that are used for acoustic test and measurement. They're used by production lines and R&D labs.
By day, I'm a tech wizard, mostly in the fields of microcontroller coding and web applications. And
the life project I recently completed is just graduating college. Recently I've been taking time, a year off between undergrad and graduate school, to work with LAP, I really wanted to just explore within LARP that sort of theater and the physicality mixed with visual artistry.
I'm a historian. I just graduated with a degree in history, and I used to work at Sturbridge Village.
Founder, main designer of Nexus Elements.
What I do, for the most part, is I am an administrative assistant. And for me, that means that, you know, I go into a place and I bring order to the chaos that is that office. Also on the staff for Aresia is the gaming division head as part of Mind's Eye Society, and on the staff for Nexus Elements as their operations manager.
It was a pretty good system. It was between 30 and 120 players. The game system lasted about 10 years, so in terms of like a New England LARP, it was pretty successful.
I started writing a novel back in high school, and about senior year I met another LARPer, and he really got me into LARP in general, and I'm like, you know what, this isn't a novel. This is a world that I've created. Decade or so, I turned that world into a LARP. Fantasy is my, like, wheelhouse.
All those fun, shady things you can do with computers. And by night, I'm a techno wizard, so I have a regular gig every month. It's called Control, K-N-T-R-L, kind of like a news station, almost. Of the two, I really sort of bounce between either Booty House or like dark, industrial-sounding techno.
I spent 8 years in a Kyokushin karate dojo. I started when I was in middle school. And by the end, I was a black belt, and I spent at least 2 years within the dojo training students.
I think I've been with LAP before LAP was a real thing. I got involved in, I guess, prototype LAP, like, fifth grade? Fourth grade? I think it was me and one other kid doing, like, buffer LARP classes. We played with Realms, so it was in a gymnastics gym at night. And then that grew, and it was just sort of this homegrown class. I think it was when I was a senior in high school that I came back and started working at the after-school program that would eventually spin off LAP. And since then, in some capacity, I've been working in LAP. I've been an instructor in the after-school program, helping the youth. I've helped design the game system that it uses. I've written a lot of the events. I've been an NPC in a lot of the events. I've run and directed events. I don't even know what else. All of it.
My official, I guess, title is I'm the head writer.
Right now I'm on the writing team for Legends of the Stars, and last year I was an NPC for it.
Been working on the story and coming up with ideas for that, and working with the writing team.
So for Legends of the Stars, I am both on the logistics team and on the writing team.
Currently on the game system.
How are we going to handle combat?
So at the first Legends of the Stars event, I was really active in directing the players into how they could manifest that saber combat fantasy within the LARP, because it's obviously a Nordic LARP and it's not a Boffer LARP, so there's a lot of gray area in how people interact and how people fight. With Boffer LARPs, there is a very clear understanding about how things work, but when there's no sort of safe object as a weapon and there's no clear rules and a lot of that has to be pre-negotiated, it requires a little bit of teaching in the beginning to have players understand, you know, how can I interact with someone that I don't know, but we both still want to fight and we both still want to have a good time, but how do we do that safely, but how do we still look cool while doing that?
I am the cricket coordinator for Legends of the Stars, which means that I kind of help organize teams and people and just kind of make sure that everybody has all the information that they need, and logistically speaking, making sure that the players have everything that they need as well.
I'm creating all sorts of interactive circuitry.
So I want to build a galaxy that players can really take agency in. and can really not just play a role, but also have an impact in terms of rewriting what we start off as. I want to build a sandbox and I want to have the players play in it and see what happens.
I try to put something in the sandbox for every player. Like, that is really, like, that is a huge value to me. Because I've experienced games where, like, I didn't really participate. where that wasn't fun. If I go to a game, I want to be the hero or the villain.
Talk with the various players, and if people want to change things on their sheets, we can certainly make accommodations for them.
And, you know, it's inspiring to see other people, what they would do with it, and I've always found, like, on my own, I come up with not necessarily great ideas, but it's working with someone else when we can kick the ball back and forth and talk about it that really good ideas come out.
We need, actually, that interaction between the players and our staff in order for this story to work properly.
So, you know, it's great to see it through a different lens.
What are we doing for the brand new players coming in? What are we doing for the returning players?
If that'll give you any ideas, but I'm really excited because the plot we've come up with, really, I love it.
The smuggler, the person that's, like, making things happen. And so I approach that by, I look at what people want to play, and I make the story turn to them, right? So you have still, as a player, you still have to have agency. You still have to get up and interact with the sandbox. Like, you can still sit in a sandbox and just look at the sand. But I'm giving you the tools, and I'm helping you with the tools to, like, create your sandcastle, create what you want to create.
Making up how things are supposed to work. Like, okay, you're playing one of the Myth or Sade. How does your force powers work? How do you represent that in a LARP?
I think it was successful most of the time. I think it definitely, because it was the first run, to be honest, it wasn't, you know, just 100% smooth sailing, but in the sense that there were no serious disasters and people were able to meet other people that they had never met before and engage in sort of physical interaction with in combat, I would say it was a success.
My job to keep the writers on track, and it's my job to make everything come together into a cohesive world and a cohesive character.
Currently, I'm working on the Mythe temples and their design and those planets and those societies and cultures.
So for run two, I am writing the faction lore for the Sade.
So a good portion of how, you know, logistics works is we set up the worlds that you get to play in and define the rules that make the universe run. And then you go with it.
So at the first Legend of Stars run, I was a teacher or instructor. I was partially a player character in the sense that I roamed the ship with the players. I interacted with the players on a regular basis. I would give the nudges in certain directions when story stuff was happening. But in general, I was there as a resource for them to just sort of be like, hey, is this, am I doing this right? You know, what sort of things are, you know, is this still within the realm of the game? Am I pressing the envelope too far and that sort of thing? And so I was really there as just sort of a wandering resource.
Maybe not necessarily animatronics, but a little bit more, I guess, special effects. I mean, I'm even working on this guy right now. I mean, yes, it's just a simple, you know, ultrasonic proximity sensor.
Working with Athlexon on tech and props, so
you kind of have your hands in everything.
I kind of have my hands in everything at this point.
Yeah, right.
I was playing a Sade faction leader in Run 1 when I was a wandering, helpful sort of player guide, and so I got to really feel what that character was like and what that faction was like and what the people within that faction wanted out of that faction. So I took all of that feedback that I got and that that experience of being with all of these other people that I didn't know at the time, but we all wanted to be part of this dark side fantasy, and I got to translate that into the writing for Legend of the Stars 2.
Make a beautiful story and help create a fantastical world for people to have fun in.
It's, I think at its simplest, it's an immersive science fiction LARP. I think it's a LARP about sort of what the nature of man, and especially cast out on a vast canvas of the galaxy, but still what individuals do and what keeps us human.
So, for me, Legends of the Stars is this huge, epic storyline that the players are not just going to be able to get involved in, but actually shape.
It's about wizards and heroes defeating evil.
Interstellar space and beings with abilities far beyond mortal ken.
It's going to be awesome. We have my writing team, we had a meeting yesterday, and we have some really interesting ideas. I don't want to give away too much.
But it is entirely about this epic, operatic space story that we're telling.
The meat and potatoes is all the same stories, right? No matter what, the setting is the setting, but the stories are all the same, no matter where you're setting.
LARP in the future generations, or it has to head into,
it shouldn't be one player or one designer's concept of what has to happen or what can't happen. It should be, if somebody wants to be the, you know, Western style rogue, awesome. If somebody wants to be the ship captain who's, you know, on a research vessel and trying to uphold strict tenets of what it means to be a starship captain, awesome. Bring that. If somebody wants to be a diplomat, galactic diplomat, and, you know, make peace among the stars, excellent, bring that as well.
You know, if you're coming in, you're really wanting to play, you know, a down and dirty smuggler, or, you know, a gunslinger, well, that fits into this world too, and we should be able to make that happen for you.
You know, you'll get to, you know, that opportunity is there for you.
You know, what's the inspiration? It's little bits and pieces from all the literature of sci-fi over the last 20 years.
That Legend of the Stars is based on certain material that is not hardcore science fiction. It is actually a fantastical story.
But the idea is that, you know, I mean, we can do anything with this.
And as a group, we're kind of discussing the hook right now and the overarching culture of the universe, and really what we're getting into is what's gonna happen.
Is to make this LARP as best as it possibly can be.
I'm really excited about the concept that we have for like the big dark plots, and just the concept, I'm not gonna give it away, but it's really cool and it appeals to me as a historian.
Love to do this, to make really special effects for LARPs.
My focus has been so much on what the galaxy looks like, what the star systems are, where the planets are, you know, what the topographical look of those planets are like. What is it like to stand on a poisonous jungle planet, or, you know, is this place a desert, or is this an empty orbit with some mysterious thing floating around in it?
Set in an atmosphere. So, Legend of the Stars for me is a fulfillment of the space opera fantasy that I think hit a lot of nerves for people in a lot of different ways. I think when my father first showed me Star Wars when I was like 4 or 5, I remember wanting to be an X-Wing pilot, and then when I saw Empire Strikes Back, it was, oh, I want to be Boba Fett, and then
you know, by the third movie, it was like, I want to be Luke Skywalker now. And so this whole world is shown with all of these different places that I could be in, and I can insert myself into and project myself into these different roles, I think is what Legends of the Stars is. And being able to tap into all of the potential in another universe, I think, is what Legends of the Stars is.
Well, we did have certain like archetypes kind of planned out, and the vibe we found really aligned like with churches. And so we have a lawful good, basically, bishops that, you know, watch over the universe, and then you have your crusaders who are more chaotic and want to bring the Mythe system elsewhere and really fight the rebellion against the Galactic Consortium.
So for the temples of the Sidhe, I drew a lot from my previous martial arts background and how in my experience teaching martial arts, even within my one style of karate, there was definitely a wide variety of how people took that, because obviously what people like myself were teaching was verbatim exactly what we had been taught, but because of where people came from in walks of life or where they were when they came to the dojo, that information would take a different form for them. And so I sort of drew upon that past experience of seeing how different people interpreted the same words and tried to take that and spin that into the Sidhe temples and see how the one idea that the Sidhe were formed by could be interpreted in many different ways.
It has some sort of mechanical knowledge.
Yes, talk to him, he might be able to help you figure out a way to reconfigure that shuttle.
Yeah. Find the engineer and bring him to me on the front of the ship.
That is fine, as long as he stands himself.
Right now, being possibly responsible for our worst problems.
And now, if I disavow it now, I will disavow it with my dying breath.
Anyone in this group that's good with computers?
I am.
Never mind. Never mind, Ancient. You don't have the faintest idea what you have just stated.
You
want to
join Legends of the Stars? You really want to get in on this? Because this is going to be a fantastic and epic story that we're telling.
People should go to Legends of the Stars because, aside from meeting a lot of good people, and there's a lot of good people at these events.
When I first heard about the project, it sounded like a really cool end game.
You don't do these sort of things, you know, just to be bored. You do them to have fun, and it is definitely going to be a blast.
Overwhelming at times. It's going to be it's going to be amazing. It's going to be dark.
Because it is going to be such an epic storyline, getting to be a part of that, getting to be able to shape that, leave your imprints on what the story is something that people really do respond to and desire, and I know people are going to want to do that.
I'm trying to think how to put this in words.
To geek out in this science fiction fantasy universe, playing what they're playing.
I said immersive before, but you're on a space station, basically. And it's the best setting possible for any kind of space traveling.
I think what's unique about it is the setting is really amazing. You know, it's a very authentic feeling ship atmosphere. And it just really creates a super immersive environment when you're inside the ship.
There's a very hard feeling to it. It's very military. It's very, like, this isn't going out and having fun in the woods. This is serious business. But that really lends itself to the atmosphere.
I think someone should go to Legends of the Stars because it's a way to experience, I think, a lot of what has inspired modern science fiction. Being on a battleship, a lot of
modern, especially American and Western science fiction, at least through, you know, the 60s, 70s, 80s, a lot of those writers had been through the military. And, like, the reason in every classic sci-fi book, like, the space army is always the Navy and has Navy ranks and Navy ships and follows the Navy, you know, setup and feel, is because all of those writers had been in the Navy, for the most part. And so a lot of that look and sort of design and feel worked its way into almost, I think, a lot of science fiction stories around that time. And then especially movies like Alien, a lot of the design choices for the human ships were definitely sort of based off of these old Navy ships and a similar look and feel to them about how everything was made and came together. And like Star Wars, George Lucas has said a lot of that came from military inspiration. All the X-Wing fights were inspired by dogfighting during World War II, and I think a lot of those ships, I would argue, also had some of that same inspiration. So you get to play in your own realistic sci-fi story. You're literally running around in the inspiration for a lot of science fiction. And so it's, one, a great way to experience that. Two, you get to experience American history. It's a historical ship. You can see, you know, all the museum pieces that are there, get a feel for what it was like to stay on that ship, which is really cool and interesting. And then it's just fun. I mean, who doesn't want to be in their own science fiction story and fire lasers around?
The source seems so rooted in, like, people and the interaction between who they are and what they want.
If you are a science fiction enthusiast, if you like to LARP outside of the this is the rails, this is what's going to happen, if you want to experience something new and interesting, I think that is the reason you're going to go to Legend of the Stars.
To be able to get out of your everyday life.
Many of the players are going to be playing the Sedai and the Mike.
Like Legends of the Stars, you get to be an arms dealer.
And there is going to be a galactic consortium that that isn't necessarily have the might and the Sedai's best interests at heart.
You get to be one that wields like dark power.
So the players are going to have to overcome this overarching, like, I won't say evil.
That's not your thing. You can go the complete opposite way. Something that I don't really get to do in real life.
To experience. LARP for me, in general, is a way of experiencing something outside myself, right? I'm not trapped in this, I'm not limited by the reality of the world. It's a way of experiencing outside of the reality of the world.
Whatever it is, you're gonna have a good time.
What I find more compelling about it is, if given a state of chaos, will the players continue into the chaos? Or will they impose their will on it? Or will the galaxy impose that kind of order? If I started in a chaotic state, but maybe no one tries to seek that golden ratio, will it come about naturally? Or is it all just gonna stay crazy?
I really liked Legends because it focused a lot on interpersonal communication as opposed to just combat, which is obviously one of the great things about Nordic style.
But also be able to share that knowledge with others. I mean, I think in a way LARP is kind of it's a learning experience.
But it's not like where you go to a traditional American LARP where it's like the plot is constantly moving forward.
I think Legends of the Stars is gonna be a LARP that's a lot different than the other experiences that I've had. I've gone to a few different international LARPs in Europe, and it's just a different feel The Nordic style LARP, the parlor LARP feel, is different than what the average American LARPer experiences.
It is a big investment to go to Legend of the Stars. I won't lie. Definitely, you know, sabers are expensive and that sort of thing, and it's definitely a step up in what you have to do to sort of appear the way you want and sort of become what you want to be than other LARPs, I think, that I've been to. But I would say the reason to go to Legend of the Stars is to be around people that are really invested in becoming a particular role in this shared fantasy, because in my experience going to a lot of LARPs, people are very insular and don't really try and connect with a lot of the overarching universe. But with Legend of the Stars, everybody is really plugged into the universe first, and then their characters and themselves.
Really good visuals and interactive art as well.
This more Nordic style, where it's like you're playing this character and next time this character might be doing something different.
But we wanted to create an atmosphere of where everyone is welcome.
The setting and the battleship was insane. It was actually really, really difficult to kind of return to everyday life after that.
And I think a LARP, a good LARP, can provide a great framework for that.
That for me is what makes a LARP really cool, and Legends of the Stars definitely has that.
What is this LARP? What it isn't is, I know we kind of advertise it as a Star Wars style LARP, but it's not a Star Wars LARP. You don't go out with these plots and these characters that you know. The concept and the feel is similar, but it's very different.
Oh, that's the best. Obviously have fun, but I think more importantly than having fun, I think it's to suspend your own disbelief. You could die and be awesome, right? You can be Obi-Wan that dies to Darth Vader and be that figure for everyone else going forward, trying to work hard to be cool. And I think if you just sort of let that go and just buy into the reality that you already are cool and that whatever you do is cool, then everybody else will buy into that too.
I think a lot of times when we design LARPs and a lot of times when we run LARPs, we try and predict the future, try and write the plot. It's like trying to write prophecy. I don't know now what's going to happen at an event in 6 months. I want players and people to see that LARP can be a lot more improv, and that regardless of what we write for them, they can also bring in story and character and spin things in interesting directions that we never thought of.
And it's original, which is really cool. What it is it's basically mythos in space. You know, it takes that old feeling of fairy tale and that old feeling of myths and legends, and it combines it with futuristic space travel awesomeness.
You're going to hear about it from your friends who did go, and then you're going to kick yourself if you don't.
That's the best game. I would say this year my goal is to create a much more clear telegraphed system, because there definitely was confusion about, well, if I'm swinging this way, how should I react? What am I supposed to do? And even though it's great to leave that open for people, because that's what you want to do at a Nordic LARP, you don't want to set really stringent rules, but without, you know, when you're interacting with somebody new, you do want to have at least some stringent rules. And so you can break those rules when you're comfortable with the other person, but there definitely needs to be a strong foundation, and I think that's what I would like to have for the second run.
Legends of the Stars and Infection, they're games. And games are only as fun as the people you play them with. And it's not just like the people that are like, you know, they're on your team or they're in your raiding party or, you know, fire team or whatever. It's also the stagehands.
Love to see it continue to be successful. I'd love to see it completely buy out.
I mean, I'd like to see it get bigger to the degree that we can have a running battleship that will seem like it's alive, you know?
So that, you know, we can be playing day and night on the ships.
We're running things behind the scenes to make sure that this entire event goes off without a hitch.
Crew members running around doing, you know, maintaining the ship and just have that atmosphere and that complete immersion.
You know, honestly, if it does continue to grow like it does, maybe doing multiple sessions instead of just the one session a year.
Well, I'd like to keep doing it.
You know, if we were to get to that level, the resources would appear.
I would love to see Legends of the Stars really flourish and blow up in the American community.
I would love to see Legends of the Stars get to the level where they don't need people like me, like we had in the first run of Legends of the Stars, where there's no need for sort of player guide type figures to walk around and sort of have players nudge them and be like, hey, is everything okay? Like, I would want a space where there are so many players that are plugged into this shared reality that's the story. Like, there's no need for sort of outside intervention, right? Just the idea, just the reality that there's maybe 100 or even like half of that, like 50 something people that are all in the same space, agreeing to abide by the same rules and agree that they are within the same reality, then that's just like it's a sandbox, right? It's a magical sandbox where now you don't need like somebody hovering above trying to pull puppet strings, right? It's people sort of running around in this one sandbox, sort of interacting and bouncing off of each other that makes the game interesting. That's what I would like to see.
A better experience for everyone. And I'd love to be able to use the whole ship so that we can make a fully immersive environment, and maybe even use multiple locations, multiple ships, a different ship that might suit our purposes better. Who knows?
I think the question really is, what does success look like? Success to me, in my mind, has always been what happens when you give up individual control? What happens when you create something and you breathe life into it and you let it go? What are the stories going to be in 10 years? What are the players going to be doing in 10 years? How is it going to grow and change in ways that I can't even think about right now? That's the most exciting thing about it. It's the potential to turn into something that's just bigger than all of us.
I wouldn't mind where we have multiple weeks that we run, and it becomes like a yearly, like this, in October, this is your destination alarm.
Have maybe some more international people come play.
We can have people who have been to it who can come back and take on an even greater role.
It's really wonderful to see my world come to life within the characters.
Still as characters in the story, but with all this extra knowledge and just the ability to build.
And I just love to see more epic storylines being made.
A bigger scaffold and system to tell this story so that maybe 3 years down the line there's a player that comes back that's been to every one.
Everything is where it needs to be at the right time.
That would be great.
Or most of them, and we can say like, alright, do you want to be the captain of the ship now? Because you know what's going on.
The special effects makeup is as awesome as it possibly can be. It's just the people that you're working with.
Community.
I just really like that kind of community feel to Legends, and the more people that you have, the more of a community you can make.
People should go because you're going to have a great time.
It's wizards in space. It's awesome.
Because it's awesome.
Because it's awesome. Star Wars, bro.
So you want to show up. You want to buy the ticket and come. We'll be right back.
we didn't really have a whole lot of gin or anything, so we just drank a bunch of rubbing alcohol with glue and water, and that's just how we did it. Matter of fact, that's where a lot of my best ideas came from, because I didn't want to use it.
Those in the spinach
drink. Well, I mean, those in the spinach drink, but also from the spinach. I remember after I drank the alcohol, rubbing alcohol water mix, you know, I had my best ideas there. I mean, really, Luke should have been a 65-year-old man with a robot head, but they wanted to go with something else.
Medfit guy.
But then the isopropyl wore off, and then I realized, oh, this isn't a good idea. Sorry, we doing this now? Then I thought I'd save my other character, Jar Jar, for something else.
The one thing is, if it became like 150 player LARP, then I would ask for more writing staff.
When's the next infection?
We're live right now on the air. What questions do you have for Eric and Alexi?
I'm really looking forward to Legends of the Stars, but I'm also really looking forward to, you guys mentioned Infection.
Infection is probably one of our more popular adult games, and I think it's a very accessible media. The premise is it's zombie survival. Mm-hmm. An infection that started at MIT in Boston has overtaken the country.
I kind of mean to put you on the spot, but... when can we expect the next Infection game?
Ooh. Wow. When is the next Infection game?
I suppose, you know, we had another announcement we were going to make later on, but I suppose we can do this as well. We are aiming for Infection, I guess it's 6 at this point, sixth run of our Infection game to be either the weekend before or the weekend after Halloween of this year.
Whoa.
And... I'm glad you're excited, because we are excited too.
Awesome! That is such good news. Okay, yeah, I'm sorry, I don't need to take up your time. I'll let other people get in line, and just will talk to you guys later.
Thank you.
Love y'all.
Thanks for calling.
Bye.
Yeah, it's such a bizarre game, because you're playing yourself in the dystopian apocalypse, and... you know, we always question, well, what would happen? What kind of person would I be if there was no government, if there was no police, if there were no rules? And then 2 days into Infection, you find out real fast. And it's surprising and freeing and beautiful and revealing about things about your human soul. Because I think we all struggle with this idea that, you know, are we good? Are we evil? You know, what horrible acts am I capable of if there was no one to, like, stop me? And then, you know, like I said, 2 days into Infection, you find out. And then you're like, okay, maybe I love this person anyways. And that is, like, such a beautiful, humane experience to have. And I just personally love Infection. And I play the most ruthless, insane character. And I no regrets, and I can't wait to play again.